Okay. Starting off, I'm going to approve the agenda. There's one addition that I added, Pat Calver, as something to bring forward in other business. Are there any other changes or additions to the agenda? Seeing none, I tend to just pass by consent. Approval of the proceedings from May 2017. Are there any changes or additions to those? Seeing none, proceedings of May 17th are approved by consent. Is there any public comment on items that are not on the agenda? Come up to a mic, sir. Identify yourself, please.
I don't know this. So just delete that slide.
Oh, all right.
All the way down the end, if you would, please.
Hello. My name is Paul Axelson, First Saint Opportune, and a carrier vessel honor. The Saint is 55 feet and the carrier is 65 feet. Carrier boat can carry 250,000 safely. Me and my family have fished herring for over 100 years, not just in this country. My grandfather came to this country in 1954. On and off, we used the herring resource to get by. This year saw a change in the management, where carrier boats were normally part of the show for a smaller boat operation that couldn't carry its own or carry enough to make it feasible. This year, the transfer limit to a carrier was limited. It started at 80,000, went to 120,000. But the federal permit that I had on my stainer said that I could catch, I think season started out at 10 trucks a week, and it went up from there because fishing was bored and such. I don't think that that's fair, is basically what I'm saying. And the federal permit that I had on my stainer, which is only 55 foot, if I combine the capacity and horsepower of my carrier and my catch boat, would still be under that capacity of that permit. So, you know, it's kind of hard to make it when you're 300, 400 miles from home and you're planning on this and it changed to something a lot less. Draft addendum one, I was under the impression to limit effort to extend the season and such, which I had no problems with. Said you work with one carrier, and I was fine with that. That wasn't a problem for me. I was like, okay, I can work with my carrier, I can do the job.
To your question before.
But the,
see, we haven't had any questions.
The underwater thing or the difference there was the added limit of two or three trucks a week, that's all you're allowed to transfer to a carrier. Which kind of caught me by surprise because there was none of that mentioned in the draft addendum one that was commented on publicly this past winter. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for the comments. Okay, next on the agenda, 2018 specifications for Area 1A, Tony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Each year, the section has the ability to set specifications for the Area 1A fishery. At the 2015 annual meeting, the section approved the Area 1A sub-ACL as a part of a multi-year specification. This specification went through 2018. The sub-ACL is 30,000 metric tons, which represents a 28.9% of the total stock-wide ACL of 104,800 metric tons. Since 2009, the section has split the Area 1A sub-ACL into trimesters, where 0% is allocated from January 1 through May 31st, and then 72.8% of the Area 1A sub ACL was allocated from June 1st through September 30th, and then 27.2% is allocated from October 1st through December 31st. Today, the section has the ability to set specifications for the area using any of the provisions that are outlined in Amendment 3.
Any questions for Tony? Seeing none, is there a motion? Doug.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move to allocate the 2018 Area 1A TAC seasonally with 72.8% available from June through September and 27.2% allocated from October through December. The fishery will close when 92% of the seasonal period's quota has been harvested and underages from June through September may roll over into October through December period.
Is there a second to the motion, Pat Keller? Any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, is there any objection to the motion? Seeing none, passes by unanimous consent. The next item on the agenda is an issue that I asked to be discussed, and Tony has a couple of slides, and then I'll talk to it.
So Richie asked me to pull together a couple of slides on the RSA process. I did ask Mike Kennedy from the Barco office to be here to help me answer any questions that the section may have about the RSA process and to make sure that I am staying on the straight and narrow
motions.
On
yes, sir.
How the process actually works.
That
resource that is on the DARPA webpage, which there was a link provided in the meeting overview, as well as I'll have one in the presentation on RSA. And it has a lot of questions and answers in there if anybody can't remember what we go through. Right. So the research set aside programs are unique federal grant programs. They are established through GARPO's fishing management plans that promote collaboration between researchers and industry on high priority issues. The RSA programs support applied research projects that are intended to support management decisions and to refine and improve stock assessments. And from each of the respective programs, either pounds or days at sea are awarded through a competitive grant process to fund the research. And the Science and Research Director at the Northeast Fisheries Science Center make the RSA selections based on technical review scores and management panelists' recommendations. So for NOAA's participation in the RSA, NOAA Fisheries implements the RSA program itself. It does a proposal review and selection process. They ensure that the research is technically sound. They ensure alignment with council research priorities, as well as oversee the regulatory and vessel permitting needs and monitor RSA harvest activities. This is a joint effort between the GARPO Northeast Fisheries Science Center as well as the council process. And for the council participation in the RSA, the council members as well as staff provide the following support for the programs. They set the RSA quota and the numbers of days at sea associated with the RSA. They develop research priorities and forward those recommendations to NOAA Fisheries. And they provide management expertise in reviewing proposals themselves. And they consider the research results to support the council's fishery decisions. And this is the link to the website for questions that you may have later on down the road. It is quite helpful.
Thank you, Tony. The concern why I put this on the agenda, a number of New Hampshire fishermen expressed concern to me, these would be lobster fishermen, about ear conflict. And because the lobster fishery has continued to move offshore and in areas where the Border Patrol boats would be fishing for herring, the lobstermen want to be prepared and know when those boats might necessary to have less damage to their deer. So they will, the handler gets contacted. When will the Midland revoke for the herring fishery at the end of the season? When is it done? And with the RSA, the unknown aspects of the RSA, we can't give them the definitive answer. We don't have any ability, the committee has no ability to determine or know exactly when the RSA will be prosecuted or where. So that is a concern to me, and I think it's something that we should look into further to see whether we can have some say, whether the commission should have a role in this process. Since putting this on the agenda, I've heard from some other commissioners that there's also some concern about how the research is picked, whether we could have some say in that as well, and also what type of vessels participate. It seems at this point it's only been midwater trawl vessels, but should there be some opportunities for first seine and smallmouth bottom trawl? So I think with all those concerns, my suggestion is that we have this on the agenda at a future meeting to try to flush all these issues out and see whether what our next step would be to work with the council to get us to be part of that process. So I guess I would ask if there any other commissioners would like to express concern and whether they think it's advisable to have this on a future agenda.
If I might, Mr. Chair, I'd like to ask Mike Petney if he might be able to provide us any feedback as to what would be the appropriate course of action that we could take, or the council could take, or the DARPA could take, that if we this section decides to be that they want to have it put into it. Is there a mechanism? What would be that? Is there any idea of what kind of mechanism that would involve? Is it something the feds would have to, the DARPA would have to determine? Would it have to be a council action? Could we do an addendum to include it? So Mike might be able to provide any input he might be able to do.
First, thank you, Mike, and I plan on calling you. First, I'd like to see if there are any other commission members that have this concern. If it's just myself, then probably this doesn't need to go forward, but if there are others, I can ask all the data first.
I can appreciate the concern that's been expressed by those fishermen in New Hampshire and Massachusetts. Some concern has been expressed in recent past about the RSA fishing by vessels, by water trawlers, possible conflicts with lobster deer. As you indicated, the lobster deer is expanding, so they're in the areas where the water trawlers fish for sea cow. So, because of that, in recent years, again, my agency has worked the water trawlers across their mostly to make them more aware of the concerns expressed by the lobster and what we overimagine the conflicts, and that led to some greatly increased communication between the captains of the vessels, the lobster and themselves. So that's one way in which we can better address the conflict issue with the lobster, maybe by including more reaction fishermen discussion, so they're able to pass on this information to the more control. So that's why I certainly don't mind it being addressed. We can bring it forward again for further discussion at another meeting, but at the same time, we've been dealing with it in that way. It may simply be a matter of just improving communication because the more control is going to be limited here for a number of reasons. Regarding the difficulty of predicting when the catches are going to occur, that is when the RSA will be used up. I share that concern. I would love to know when it's used up. I mean, my agency is doing a lot of the administration of the RSA. Staff working very closely with RSA fishermen to accomplish the objectives that we have set for ourselves, such as increased sampling of the landings, spawning condition of the fish, move-along strategies to deal with possible bycatch issues. So I'd love to know what the RSA is over too, but from talking to my staff, it all depends upon where the herring are and when the herring are. And they also, the boats tend to hold some of that RSA allocation for later on when they go fishing for mackerel, because they want to catch herring and they need to have that as part of that catch. So it's kind of unpredictable. And I think it's just need more communication with those individuals involved in our situation. So those are some of the points I wanted to make. And indeed, we as a section decide to have more discussion about this at our next meeting, then I'm looking forward to have staff come and give a presentation regarding the RSA fishing that we do, and provide, again, more insight as to what can be done and what has been done.
Thank you, David. Pat?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think David had a lot of very good comments on the statement. We have, we're allowing lanes to come into the main outside of the province. So we're managing the land of RSA product through our special licenses. And by doing so, we have the ability to put additional restrictions on. If we're going to have additional conversations, then we're going to be happy to bring information related to how we're handling the state of Maine, maybe something that would be transferable. Your points on your conflict together a technical review
technical review, and if the section is interested in providing members or technical staff as a resource to participate in that process, we'd be happy to entertain it. It's always good to have a wider pool of potential technical reviewers, so we're not asking the same people over and over again to review a lot of proposals. We do have to be a little bit concerned about conflict of interest, but that's why having a wider pool of potential technical reviewers is a good thing. So I encourage you to consider that as well. The next phase is issuing the EF, selecting the projects. Next phase is selecting the projects. And I just want to point out that we select projects based on the proposer. And at that point, we don't necessarily know what vessels are going to be involved. As a research institution or state agency, whoever is putting forth a proposal, we're looking at the merits of that proposal. The aspect that generally causes concern or where the issues arise is from compensation vision, and that is the way that the projects are effectively funded. And when we approve projects, we don't necessarily know what vessels are going to be engaged in compensation vision. As I said, we're focusing on the merits of the proposal itself. And we also get directly involved in telling investigators, researchers, what vessels they can or can't use. We allow them to establish private agreements and arrangements with the vessels that they feel are best suited to either help them conduct the research or best suited to do the compensation vision to help fund the work. But all of those vessels are eventually sent to us when the applicant then applies to the exempt fishing permit, which is what allows the compensation vision to operate when the fishery would otherwise be closed. At that point, we do a sanction check on the vessels that are proposed, and assuming that the sanction checks are clean, then we issue the EFPs. I'll note that the EFPs, that EFP review process is one where when we receive an application for an exempt fishing permit, we notify the council, we notify the states for which where the activity is taking place. I believe we notify the commission as well that we've received an EFP application and we solicit comments on the EFP. When we decide to issue the EFP, we also notify the states that we're issuing the EFPs. So that will give you a sense of when the EFP is being authorized and when the fishing activity may take place. We can certainly be happy to work with you on improving communication, which Dr. Pierce suggested. If there are ways that we can do that better, do a better job of that, provide more information. I think it's important to understand that the EFPs that we issue explicitly state that the EFPs are exempting vessels from federal regulations and do not waive or exempt vessels from any state regulations that may apply. So if there are things the state is concerned about that would help from a state perspective address the concerns, there's an opportunity there because our EFPs do not override any state regulations. And that, I'm going to stop there for a second, see if there's any follow-up questions or if I'm missing anything that's all I'd like to touch on.
Thank you, Mike. That was very helpful, and we have gotten copies of the email and text alerts that are going to be going out that you will begin fishing. So that clearly is helpful. That can be expanded. If there's some way of expanding that as to where they're going to fish when those go out, that would go a long ways to solve the conflict problem. So are there any questions for Mike? Well, seeing none, thank you, Mike. What is the pleasure of the commission? Would you like to see this as an agenda item in the future, or do you think that we've received enough information at this point? Anyone in favor of having an agenda item? Seeing none, we'll close this agenda item. And next is a discussion of New England Fisheries Management Council participation in Atlantic States. And we welcome Terry to the table for this discussion. Tony, the presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So currently, the section can invite the council, any council, to participate on specific issues as non-voting members on an issue-by-issue basis. And the section has done this, for example, under Amendment 3, the section invited the council to sit and participate in the discussions as we make final decisions, as we went through the process of developing and approving Amendment 3. This summer at the MRCC meeting, the Northeast Regional Coordinating Council requested that the commission consider having the New England Fishery Management Council as a voting member of the Atlantic Hearing Section. Provisions within the ISFMP charter only allow for council participation on management boards. Amendment 1 in the compact specifies that states can come together to form sections, but that does not include any federal management agency or body. So in order for the council to have a voting seat on the Atlantic Hearing Section, the section would then need to become a management board. So the policy board discussed this a little bit at our meeting in August. They asked the hearing section to have a discussion on this issue and make a recommendation back to the policy board on what the section is interested in seeing us move forward with.
Tony, could you go over any other changes to the section becoming a board? So will the services have a seat at the table at that point?
Any management board can have both NOAA Fisheries, U.S. Fish and Wildlife on the management board. They can participate in any management board they would like to participate in. It's not an invitation. It is automatic if they would like to be part of that. The management board would then need to invite the council to participate. And the council's, what happens in the charter is that you can invite the councils, and then the councils can decide if who they want to represent them, if they want more than one council to be participating. It's just one seat for a council.
Any questions or comments? Tom?
I remember going to my first Atlantic Hearing section many years ago. It was actually the only place where a governor's appointee or legislative appointee had a vote, because the section was set up different than the boards. It's a long history here. I like the way it runs now. I have no problem if you want an official member on, but I don't think I want to change it to a board. It seemed to work well. We have all the states represented, they talk about it, work out things from themselves. If we need information, like we did, invited the council to come as an official member and sit at the table, I have no problem with that. But I don't see that we need changes to a management board and all the other things that entails.
Thank you, Tom. David?
Yeah, I guess my first question would be, if we were to become a board, expanding membership, does that then preclude three states, Maine, Massachusetts, and New Hampshire, from getting together as we move now and as we have done for many years to talk about fishing days restrictions or days out, to very quickly make changes in how we deal with the corporate jobs and where we want to go? I do not want to make any changes in how we do our business if it's going to slow us down and stop us from doing that, because it's been very effective. That would be my first question.
Can I answer that? Doug, do you want to answer that? Is that?
Well, I'll let staff back it up on this, but that three-state Area 1A group is specifically outlined in the plan. It has nothing to do with whether we're a board or a section. It says, excuse me, the commissioners from New Hampshire, Massachusetts, and Maine get together to do A, B, C, D, E. And the board has given us the authority to do that, or the section has. So it wouldn't change anything from my standpoint, and Tony Flop, correct me, I don't think that changes. I don't think there would be federal representation or council representation on that without a change to the management plan.
Dave, do you have an additional?
I guess another point. My preference is to leave it as is, to have the council member be a non-voting member. If indeed the council wants to be involved in those sorts of discussions, fine enough. But then again, I'll mention again, I'm a council member. Doug is a council member. We have council members already making decisions relative to how we deal with that very important thing we want to call it. And then it's a complication. So we have a council member, another council member who's not state, let's say, become a voting member of the session. And that is, we have now likely state imbalance. Right now it's the states and as individuals with our counterparts and voting as one. But now if another individual is put on board, let's say somebody from Massachusetts, or Massachusetts has two votes now. In contrast, the state may have one vote and in New Hampshire having one vote. Or the council puts Terry Stockwell on because of the wealth of knowledge that Terry Stockwell has. There's two main votes, one in New Hampshire and one in Massachusetts. So the fishing industry will see this and they'll understand what's happening. They might think it's a way to stack the deck in a way that might favor one state over the other. So right now, we all work together very well. And I frankly don't see the need for another council member to be put on the board. We don't do anything that's not above board. It always is. We leave the council. So, if the council, apart from having a state representative, state director on the section, the council wants somebody else to be on the board, provide information to assist the discussion, that's fine, but a non-voting member would be my preference.
Thank you, David. Dennis, have you next?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm not in favor of this. I'll say that right from the outset. David mentioned a few of the things that I was concerned about. Whether they were participating in the meeting in New Hampshire and Massachusetts when we do the season setting, et cetera. Whether they sit there or not, but once they become a voting member, then they have an influence on our future decisions, and that could change things down the line. The first thing that I asked myself was, what advantage does that offer to the section, their participation? And I couldn't see any, being that they could be invited, they can offer their positions, they can be an ad hoc type member and provide us whatever information they would like. But what we're really doing here is invite them, because we're now giving them a vote that we have, and I don't think that they should have. Again, I support them participating, but I do not at all support them voting. And again, down the line, you know, they could affect our decision making. Sometimes we have meetings, full meetings, and we barely have a quorum, and if they're there, it just upsets the balance that we have. I think we're trying to cure a problem that doesn't exist by inviting them to be a voting member. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Dennis. Doug?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think most of you have heard me speak in favor of switching to a board in the past. I believe in any management plan that we go down with, I think there is benefits to having both the service, because we are co-managing the species with federal agencies and the council, and if the council would like to be a member of it and a board member of it, I think that would end up making our decisions stronger and better on this. I don't think we should try and manage this in a vacuum when clearly some of the decisions we have impacts on federal carbon holders and the actual fishing that goes on out in the EEZ. So I would strongly support, even though I'm here, I can count the votes right there, that the section at some point start to think about making a recommendation to
switch to a board. I don't think we should be afraid of having both National Fisheries Service and the Board of Council here as board member. It can make us a stronger, our management actually stronger than that.
Thank you, Doug. Pat?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've actually I've been opposed to this, but I've been leaning a little bit more in the direction of allowing it. Although Dave has brought up a lot of good points as for Dennis. I would like to hear directly from Mr. Stockwell on really why, what are the specific areas that they're looking at engaging in when it comes to hiring from a commission perspective? And maybe that would help better give us guidance on maybe potentially narrowing the participation in the areas to help offset some of the concerns that we've heard from seven.
Thank you, Pat. Terry?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, members of the hearing section, for indulging in my participation today. I'm sitting at this table with a very different hat on than a year ago when I made the motion to initiate the NM1, which was populated with a number of management measures that were that the state of Maine wished to have in place to more effectively manage the herring fishery effort in Area 1 during trimester 2. This year, I'm solely wearing my council hat. And while there's been a lot of comments about the ability of state directors to advocate for both processes at the same time, I really want to underscore the prior day my sole responsibility to the state of Maine when I'm sitting at this table, not the council that I'm paid, and vice versa. I disagree that adding another member from the council will stack the deck. I think that the council member will whether or not it was a state representative or another member will help fully, more fully advocate for the federal advocacy. And I do want to mention that the council has added a voting member for the lobster board to have that committee. The primary purpose of the council requesting representation is to improve the coordination of management efforts. The council doesn't want to get involved in the three states' spawning process. The council's concern is the commission is taking action that is inconsistent with the federal management plan and usurping the council's authority in this resource. I want to highlight the comments that were made from the public about the NM1 and that the section, the action of the section avoids the need of management change to the council. While it takes longer, they've made with full analyses and an opportunity for formal public comment. The two big issues that are before the council right now are one, still a little bit of blowback from Addendum 1 to Amendment 3, and the issues that were forwarded to the council through a non-voting member this past spring, and the letter received by the council from the commission picking the RSA project. The council has not answered that letter yet. And it was probably will not until after the winter meeting when it's a little bit clear to council what direction the section's going to go. So I can review it too.
Good afternoon, early morning tomorrow.
I'd like to pursue a more collaborative way to move forward. And I do agree on our opinion on this. On the hearing section of the council, way back when we'll be both processed.
We're working to get those motions squared away before him. Yeah, people doing motions, we want them to be there a half hour before, so we can touch base, me and Caitlin.
Interested in having a section member as a voting member on the hearing committee?
I do, but I can't speak for full council input. We have an executive committee meeting coming up this next month, and that is on the executive committee's agenda.
Tom?
We're not just adding one council member, we're adding two services. And over the years, this has been functioning really well. and I know that the two services tried to be objective, but sometimes over the years, they have been the swing vote in allocation battles. And when we're sitting around the table, the stakes involved, there's a lot more effort to make it fair to everybody sometimes. And we don't have those two votes to counteract with. I'll be honest, I think we should stay the same. I have no problem with an official member sitting for the council. They didn't invite us, they basically opened up the winter flounder to 5,000-pound trip limits and done in the vacuum as far as the middle end, as far as the commission was done and everything else, and there's no voting member there. I can't support this.
Thank you, Tom. It looks like we're going to need a motion because it looks like we're not unanimous. And any other comments first before I ask for a motion?
I think the key word here that the heritage is just collaboration. And I'm not sure we need voting members from ASFC and the commission or council and vice versa. I think we need to find a better way to ensure that we're collaborating on this. It would seem to me that that is the most important component. Last year we had some objections by council members, council staff, including suggestions by the executive council, by the director, that we were overstepping the bounds by putting proposals in place on federal permit holders. The state of Maine puts those type of controls on federal permit holders all the time in our state of Maine. They've been upheld all the way to the Maine Supreme Court. So I'm comfortable from a state perspective, and that gives me comfort from a commission perspective that we have the rights and the abilities to do what we did. Whether it's right or wrong, that's for a different day and a different discussion. But it seems to me a better way forward is to maybe get council and commission staff along with some members from both bodies together to talk about how we could do a better job collaborating on this species instead of talking about changing the section for the board this time.
Thank you for that, Eric.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm relatively new kid on the commission, and I'm also a relatively new kid on the council. I haven't been in the area management business since whenever. But I agree with what Terry said, a lot of things. When you sit at this table, I'm from Rhode Island, and I represent the interests of the state of Rhode Island. When I'm on the council, I'm bound by my oath to take care of the interests of the nation as a whole, which is New England and Paradise, the nation as a whole, but that's all. Herring is a very complicated thing. Anybody that knows anything about herring management of herring is an extremely complex thing. Mike and I have been working on herring for 12 years, but it's still not. To avoid having the best minds at the table means avoiding having someone in the council here, and I don't think that's smart. It's not the more you carry, but it's the more informed people he has in the discussion. That's very important to that fishery and a lot of other fisheries. Whether or not
one of the key steps that already has been taken, and I suspect will continue to be taken, is just including the room and council staff that goes with CCAP in our discussions. And I think our ISMC staff does a wonderful job working with the counterpart and with the council. That's the way it always has been. We've had the past meetings, and then the council staff come to relieve us, and then vice versa. So that's worked really well. One issue that continues to haunt me that I take issue with is the fact that there has been in the past still said that states are usurping federal authority, and therefore the council should be more involved, let's say, as a voting member. Well, I don't agree with that. That's already addressed it. We're not usurping federal authority. Frankly, we're making federal rules work. And we do more than what the federal government, the New England Council specifically has done, what more officials can do, specifically the spawn closures. But it hasn't been for the states not controlling the catches of federal permanent fishing on the federal borders. They did the unbridled fishing on spawn fish. And you know, we lay claim to fame that we've done quite a lot to protect spawn fish. That's one of the hallmarks of what we have done for effective sea hammering management. Years gone by, the council tried it, but couldn't do it. Couldn't implement federal rules that would control the catch of spawning fish. So we did it. And we did it in a collaborative way. And we continue to be that way. So, again, having the council members be part of the session as a non-voting member, I'm fine with that. But as a voting member, I just don't see the need for it.
Dennis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just listened to Eric talk about what he's required to do essentially as a member of the commission and also when he's sitting as a member of the New England Council. It made me think of the fact that we have before us something that the New England Council has brought before us now, the person of the chair being a representative. And we're preparing to vote while we sit here at the table with a goodly number of council members. And to me, this raises an issue of conflict of interest in whether they should even be voting on this, because they're bringing it forward, so they're going to have a biased, possible biased vote. Should they not exclude themselves from voting? Should we put this whole thing aside and leave things as they are, as it appears, rapidly and suggested? And I'm serious when I say
that. Thank you, Dennis. One of the things I was thinking about, I don't even think I'd get a second to turn this into a board right now. I certainly would support the section continuing to allow council member to sit as a non-voting member, to increase the communication between the council's management plans and the section's management plans, so they can bring that kind of information back and forth and provide input. As I provide input to the section, I agree to the council's plan, what we're doing. But one thing that we do every 3 years that is similar in management is set specifications. And one of the things that I've always been a little frustrated, it seems like this section has been in the position of essentially rubber stamping what the council has already approved for specifications. And one thing that we might do to help do more collaboration with the council is when it comes time to setting specifications, maybe the area committee and the area section could have a joint meeting, so that instead of the section just being rubber stamped, that we talk about some of the issues, such as the RSA,
the same time. And I just throw that out there for consideration. We'll be coming up this year, we'll be developing specifications again. And does this section want to try and reach out to the council, along with maybe an offer to have an ongoing member on our section to see if we could set the specifications for the joint meeting?
Thank you, Doug. Right.
Yeah, you'd have to explain it to me, Doug, because if I'm not mistaken, you sit on the Hearning Committee. I believe Pat Keller sits on the Hearning Committee. And David Pierce had the representative Caleb Keith sitting on the Hearning Committee. So how could you bring in the Hearning section to meet with the Hearning Committee? I'm more in favor of Dennis Adams, and he can put it up as a motion, but I'd rather not see council members vote on this. I would rather let the other state delegate commissioners vote on this here today. But I don't understand where you're going with that, because once again, you've got people sitting here who sit on the council. As a matter of fact, all three members, Pat Calhoun, yourself, and Dr. Pierce, and you three then should be able to inform the council on what the commission's opinion is, I would think.
Let me summarize where I think we are. Get the sense that the section is not ready to vote to become a board today. But I also hear that we need increased communication with the council. We can take a vote either today or in the future to extend the seat that Terry now sits in as a non-voting member after Amendment 3 is passed, at least here until Amendment 3 is completed. So we could extend that at that time just by a vote of this board to this section to continue that seat as a non-voting member. Would it make sense that the chair and possibly a couple other commissioners meet with the chair of the council and talk about how we might increase communication? Is that, do you think that makes any sense? And then we can, in the future, extend the seat as a non-voting member if we decide to. Turn.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. We did have a discussion about this at the NRCC meeting in the spring. I'm sure it will come up again between the council and the commission and DARPA in the November meeting. But I won't say quid pro quo, but I mean, you're asking for participation on the RSA program and slamming the door in councils to participate in section. That might be a tall order. To bring people together to come up with a reasonable resolution.
Tom?
Yeah, I find this an interesting conversation. First of all, New York and New Jersey sit on this, it would be the New England Council to send a representative, wasn't it? It would have been the Atlantic Council. The same thing with the Harry, with the Florida situation. I just find that a little strange. Again, I have no problem inviting a person from the New England Council to sit on here. I wish it would be a different participation than it normally is, and have you stop from being from the same state. So we can't do that. But we're going to look at things, and we might start working together with councils when we choose the Mid-Atlantic to sit on, like the Winter Files Board. One of the members from the southern states to sit on with the final board and make sure our concerns on the stock that's not being rebuilt. So we're going to start this negotiation and talk. We should talk about all the boards, not just her.
Sarah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I'm sitting here listening to the conversation and thinking about your last comments, that maybe there could be a working group that comes together to look at ways to enhance communication. I think that's really what the nub of the matter is that we're talking about, because as somebody doesn't participate in New England Council, I guess I'm curious how adding them as a non-voting member to this section, or making it a board and having them be a voting member, how that's going to increase communication when we've already identified there are four members of this section that already wear two hats, a New England Council hat and an SMC hat. And if those four people can't find a way to communicate what each board is thinking to, or the section of the board to the section, how adding an additional person to advise us or be a non-voting participant, how five is going to be the magic number when we have a communication problem now with overlap of 4 members. So I think that we're kind of going down a rabbit hole here, and maybe we all need to take a step back and look at ways to enhance communication as opposed to thinking about adding people to a section or not. Thank you.
Pat.
Oh, sure. I got you. This one?
No.
All right. Here we go. I'm ready.
I move that the section you recommend to the business committee that we send.
Is it policy board or business?
To the council, the council, suggesting the establishment of a working group with the goal of improving communications.
Is there a second? Tom voted. Anybody want to speak to the motion? No.
Yeah, thank you. I would support this. I think there's a lot of ways that we can get at improving communication, coordination, area management between Commission and Council. And I also wanted to sort of address the concerns by some commissioners that the state directors that are on both the ASMC section and Council might have some kind of conflict of interest. We at both entities, the council and the commission, we represent the state, our state, in this case. And it's not any kind of conflict for us to be representing our state in both types of entities. Not like we're doing this in conflict with the federal agencies. We're cooperatively managing this piece together, better than the resources and better than the industry. And that's what our goal is here.
Thank you, Doug. Any other comments? Go ahead.
Is the intent of this to be herring specific? Because as this is laid out right here, going to the policy board, it suggests communication on all species. So, I mean, is that an issue? Do we want the policy board to take that up? Because I would presume if there's a communication problem with one species, there's probably communication problems in other species. So, where do we want to go with this? Is this current specific, or are there other issues that this is going to accommodate?
Thanks, Adam. This is meant to be parent specific. While I always agree that maybe some other communication issues that I related to other species, parent is one of the most complicated have to manage my staff says it's not complicated, it's just complex. Well, whatever complex or complicated, it's, there's a lot of moving parts here. I'd like to keep this very specific there.
Tom?
As a second to the motion, I did because I wanted to start opening up the communication on just before more than inherent, I moved to file and a couple others.
I don't think, Tom, that that would be an issue for this section. So I think that's something that should be brought up to the policy board as a separate matter because we're not involved in other species. So I think this motion, as Pat said, it's appropriate to herring, and if you want to expand that, then that would be done at the policy board.
Rich, that's not what I said. I said, I understand this one is to herring. I'm saying, I hope that's a start, that in the future we go some other direction and we work in other boards that I had no idea. I was strictly doing this for herring.
I apologize, I didn't hear you correctly, Tom. Thanks. Anybody else before we vote? Seeing none, is there any objection to this motion? Seeing none, passes unanimously by consent. Okay, we're into other business. Pat.
Thank you, Chairman. I know we're running against the clock here, and I certainly don't want to stand in the way of food. But the second trimester Area 1A fishery this year, as was pointed out by Mr. Ackerbaugh, actually, as I was approaching the last meeting, also, my apologies. We did have different goals this year to extend the harvest of that quarter out into the middle of September. In doing so, that's pushing more of the harvest in a time when we're going to see spawning fish. And throughout this, the end of that trimester, into this next trimester, I've been getting complaints of a lot of spawn fish being caught, people wanting to go back to the way we were doing it in the past. I mean, I've heard the gamut. We had a technical committee make changes to the way we were looking at the way we were feeding data to the model. I'm not suggesting making the model biased, but potentially that model could be biased by the inclusion of data and the expansion of data points into it. And I'd like to make a motion for because of that. If I get a second, we can discuss this further, but it's fairly, well, it's long, but it's fairly simple. It's just to move to task the technical committee to revisit the 2017 fishing season relative to the goals and objectives of Amendment 3 and comment on the effectiveness of the current spawning management measures, make suggestions on technical or management changes to better meet those goals and objectives. And if time allows, make research recommendations to maximize effectiveness and better report management. And then the TC would report back to the motion, report back to the board at the learning meeting.
Is there a second? And it's out. I guess I would have a question for Tony. Is this something you think the technical committee has the time to do for the learning meeting?
Sure. You have that technical committee doesn't have some serious, any large agenda items on their task list, which you have a task list in front of you in the supplemental materials. There are individuals on that technical committee that do have other things going on, such as Matt. And, but Matt did let me know that this might be coming up. My bigger concern here is implications of what the recommendations may be and the decisions that would come after that. Because if we're looking to make changes to how we deal with the spawning closure system, that likely would need to be revisited through an addendum, which, if that is going to happen, we would want to consider that for the action plan and the budget for next year. I didn't budget to have a meeting of this group, but it is also just three states that are quite close together, so I don't think it would be a very costly meeting to have. did raise his hand, and so I want to.
Bob, you want to comment?
I was going to say some of the things that Tony said, but, you know, I think in general, this tasking looks to me like one conference call, just have a discussion on sort of how things went this year, and doesn't seem like a whole lot of complex analysis, unless I'm missing something like that. And then, you know, a report back to the board. So, hey, you know, I think we can do it by the winter meeting, but I reserve the right to go back and spend some time with the technical folks to make sure I'm not, you know, overburdening those folks with the task. And if, yeah, once we talk, if there's something that we, you know, it seems like it's going to take longer than between now and the winter meeting, we'll let the section know.
Thanks, Bob. David.
I think this is the first year in which we've operated under new rules for this one group and once. We made some very important changes in how we implement monitoring and respond approaches. So it would seem that now we can find time to take a look at how it works and get some reaction from the industry and get more communication between the technical committee and the industry itself to us or independent of us. So these tasks are very reasonable, and I don't think we can take that off.
Any other questions or comments? Ready for the motion? Right.
I'll say it again, I've heard it for years. Are we ever going to address sworn enclosures on Georgia's Bank and Nantucket Shoals?
That would be another discussion. Is there any objection to this motion? Seeing none, motion passes by consent. Is there any other business? Seeing none, I just want to make a couple of comments. This is my last meeting as chair. I want to thank staff, Ashton, and then Hilly pulling in after Ashton left. And I'd really like to thank the three administrative commissioners from New Hampshire, Maine, and Massachusetts, because the days out process happens very quickly, and communication is extremely important. And these three commissioners made it very easy to get a hold of them. And I hope that continues for the next chair, David. So thank you. And there's nothing else, then we are adjourned. Thank you.
Before everyone hops up, just as a reminder, the buses are leaving for the aquarium at 5:25, 5:35, 5:45. We all cannot fit on the 5:45 bus, so we encourage you folks to go down to the 25 and 35 bus and head over, and there will be food and beverages available when you get there. So earlier you go, the earlier you get out of
here. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Richie White.
Thank you.
Pretty please.
Of course.
So,
I saw that.
As we were gone.